Good morning, everyone, and happy Easter. It is such a joyful feeling to be able to say that to all of you after what feels like, honestly, an entire year of Lent, not just our past 6 weeks of official Lent. There seems to be light at the end of the tunnel coming, and that's a blessed thing to know as we celebrate this day of resurrection. I want to welcome all of you, but that's especially true if you're here for the first time this morning. And if that's the case, I hope that you'll go to our website and drop us a note there so that we can be in touch with you if you'd like for us to do that, to share a bit more about our life with God here at St. Mark's and how you might be able to get connected. One opportunity for that is later today at 12 o'clock, we'll be doing an Easter Day coffee hour. Also, for those of you watching online this morning, as you are, there's a drive-up communion from 11:30 until 12. So know that you can come by the 9th Avenue side of the church and receive a bag with communion and some other surprises in it. I also want to give a special thanks to the many hands who worked extra hard this year on putting together our Easter celebration. Extra videos, the people who came in and did all of the flowers, who did all of it a week ahead of time. It's been a wonderful thing, and even more people than in a normal year to thank for their participation. So thanks to all the hands who made this a special day. And now let's worship.
Thank you.
Alleluia! Christ is risen!
Christ is risen indeed! Alleluia!
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Let Israel now proclaim, his mercy endures forever. The Lord is my song and my strength, and he has become my salvation. There is a sound of exultation and victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has punished me sorely, but he did not hand me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. He who is righteous may enter. I will give thanks to you, for you answered me and have become my salvation. The same stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. On this day the Lord has acted. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
A reading from Acts. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, and everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there's the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." I would bet that nearly all of you remember the story of that first Easter morning ending more or less just about like that, with the arc of the story ending there, at that place with messengers being sent out to share the good news. In the other three Gospels, the details differ about exactly which configuration of disciples were there, and who told whom, and who did not believe whom when they heard it. And in case you were wondering, it's the men who did not believe the women. The number of angels or lack thereof, the presence of Jesus himself at the tomb, only in John, whether or not the grave clothes were lying there. These details differ, but I would bet you remember thinking that in every version, somebody or other goes out and tells somebody or other else, and the news starts to spread right at the very start, that very first morning. But that's not where we just ended, because the lectionary editors finally got brave enough to stop the reading at what was the original ending of Mark's Gospel. And since Mark's Gospel is the oldest, the ending of the very first one ever written down, which was this: "So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." the end, period, nothing more. When Mark set things down himself, he stopped there. Here's what got added later and what our gospel book still has, giving us what we used to hear on Easter morning. It's the so-called shorter ending of Mark. There's another addition too, but in our gospel book, this is where things stopped. And all that had been commanded them, they told briefly to Peter, those around Peter. And afterwards, Jesus himself sent out through them from east to west the sacred and imperishable proclamation of eternal salvation. It doesn't sound a bit like Mark. And to be honest, it doesn't really even sound like Jesus. If you posted that online today, one of those AI plagiarism trackers would pick it up in a heartbeat, would flag your English teacher and say, "No way did the same person write those last two sentences." I'm just saying here. And this year, in all the additional flurry of things like filming Easter way before Easter was here, Deacon Ginny got sent the wrong gospel. The original draft bulletin said we'd use John, which is what I'd first chosen. There's always a choice. You can use John, the traditional reading, or the Easter story from the gospel you're reading through that year. So for us in 2021, from Mark. But somehow Ginny had gotten sent Matthew from last year's bulletin, which meant that she was forced to come back in for a do-over, which she did very graciously, I might add. And since I now had a chance to make a change if I wanted to, I decided I'd choose the Mark reading, which these days now stops at its true ending. I'd never opted for it before. I had to take a deep breath and almost didn't do it. Because really, who wants to hear an Easter story that ends with, "So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." It doesn't sound very joyful. It doesn't sound very much like our triumphant holy day, as we just sang. It seems like it ends in a dark, depressing place, with fear, with shock and dismay, with confusion. If you read only this section of the gospel, you might be tempted to rag on these women, but you shouldn't. They'd been faithful to Jesus throughout his ministry, staying at the cross until the bitter end, even when other disciples had run away. Mark tells us that on Good Friday, watching in horror as their beloved friend was dying a torturous death, watching as their hopes for a new world were dying with him, there were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the Younger and of Joseph, and Salome. They used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. Mary Magdalene and Mary, mother of Joseph, even stayed on long enough to be present when Joseph of Arimathea got permission to take Jesus' body down off the cross to at least give it the dignity of a proper burial. So these were faithful, brave women who showed up at the tomb as soon as they properly could to care for the body of this one they loved. You can only imagine their traumatized grief. Yet still, they did what one does in the face of death, even horrifying death. They put one foot in front of the other and went to take care of the details. You can imagine why they'd been worried about the detail of the stone, how they could manage to move the enormous thing, and perhaps their unsettled shock when they arrived to find it already rolled away. But it's simply not possible for you and I to imagine what they felt like when they stepped inside and saw that their beloved's body was not there, and that some stranger was there. This doesn't happen. Dead bodies stay put. The dead stay dead. We all know this. Strangers don't show up with incredible messages, messages that are literally incredible, as in not credible, not believable. Those women knew how the world works. And you and I know how it works too. When the person you love dies, they stay dead. Oppressive governments keep their power by violence. It was true when Rome was oppressing those first followers of Jesus, and it's true now. And so then, as now, people who try to say there's a better way, a different way, still die. Our nation, our world, seem to be in greater upheaval than we've ever known in our lifetimes. Hate and fear seem to be gaining ground. Pandemics sweep around the globe and take out 2.7 million people, some of them beloved by us, and all of them our brothers and sisters. And truly, you all, that's why I chose this gospel, because it seems so honest. It seems so true to the way our own existence feels right now in this second year of a pandemic, on this second Easter that we've had to face without the usual blessed cramming together in pews to make sure everyone who wants to be can be here to shout our alleluias again and to hear the trumpets live and to actually smell the lilies. That's how it should be, and it's not. And the grief and pain of the last year are still more than I think we've even begun to process. So this year, the experience of these three disciples seems utterly understandable. They too were grieving and in shock. They too were facing circumstances they could not have begun to imagine. Perhaps this year, more than any other, we can actually place ourselves more fully into the emotional and spiritual place they must have found themselves in on that Easter day before they could know it was an Easter day. Because here's the thing, my friends. Resurrection doesn't always happen with lightning speed, with the lights suddenly up and the trumpets blaring and the bells ringing and the alleluias being shouted after their six-week silence. Sometimes it takes longer than that to believe the good news, longer for the shock and trauma to wear off, and the fear of the utterly unknown and new to begin to subside. We know the end of this story, but they didn't. And if we're truly letting resurrection happen to us, truly letting new life seep in and change the shape of our world, and the shape of everything we've expected, it's a frightening thing, even if it's good, even if it means that things have begun that will surpass our wildest imaginations. Sometimes we have to let things sink in slowly, open our hearts to them over time. It can take courage to let Easter happen inside us, to set aside things that have died, and to welcome the new. The resurrection happened, whether you and I recognize it or not. God vindicated everything Jesus had said and done and been. God's reign was breaking in, just as he told them. He had brought it with himself. The systems that oppressed human beings really could change, were changing, and it could happen in their own lives, that change. In fact, it had to happen in their own lives if it was going to happen for the rest of the world, the way God wanted it to. And the way it could happen was through love. The love that had led Jesus all the way to his death. It was through his death and resurrection that God could vanquish all death, could prove once and for all that love was stronger than hate, that putting others before self really was wise and holy and life-changing, that it can change the world, which was the point of the whole thing to begin with. But we have to believe this ourselves, because the truth is, if resurrection doesn't happen inside you, for you, then it doesn't matter to you. If it can't meet you in your suffering or grief, it's irrelevant. If its love can't be an agent to transform your own life, then it's not worth listening to this or any other sermon. The resurrection simply cannot be a doctrine. It must be able to transform our lives, starting right inside of us. And always, always, resurrection happens in the dark, inside the tomb, with no human witnesses. Not a single one of our differing gospels put someone there. And that is good news, my friends, because it is only mystery that can carry the full weight of our lives, the full weight of the very real death and grief and sadness that have surrounded us this year. Any trite attempts at explanation, any human language that tries to pin down resurrection and either explain it away or prove it really happened, either one will not bear the full weight of our experience. At least not mine. At least not that of those first women at the tomb. And I'm pretty sure not yours either. So this year, I chose Mark. I chose the place where belief wasn't always easy, didn't always happen quickly, the place where transformation and deeper understanding took some time. I chose Mark because he seems to understand this, and I thought you might understand it too. And here's another thing that seems important to note that made me choose Mark for this still COVID celebration of Easter. He points to it in the very first words of his gospel. Do you remember? Way back in Advent? The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The way he began and the way he ended makes sense when put together. His ending wasn't crazy, wasn't not good news. He simply knew that this is how it feels when we're just beginning to see, and that we'll spend the rest of our lives seeing fully, and that the story is never really over. It's never finished until love finally reigns. The resurrection isn't the end of the story. It's merely the beginning. Mark obviously knew that the story didn't end with those women staying silent. Else how would he have known it himself? He simply knew that believing, knowing it in our bones, often starts in fear and confusion and doubt, and that it always starts in one place in order to move us to another, which is the only way new life can come, but it can often be scary. So shout your alleluias, sing in your loudest voices if you can this morning, and praise God for it. But if you can't, not just yet, know that's okay too. It happened whether you and I believe it or not. We simply have to decide at some point to let it happen in us. Amen. And now let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
We come with anticipation on this first day of the week as witnesses, sharing in the resurrection life of Jesus, as we pray, Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Eternal One, you have filled your church with new life and empowered us through the conquering love of Jesus. Raise us with your Spirit that we may live in the power of Christ's resurrection to bring life and light to all the world. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The right hand of the Most High has triumphed over evil and death, bringing new hope to all the world. Speak your living truth unto everyone who leads and holds authority among the nations, that they may be agents of life and justice. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The Apostle Peter has taught us that you show no partiality, O God, but you accept all who live reverently and do right. Let your peace extend to every person, that the power of evil and injustice may be banished, and all people may live as beloved children of the divine. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Be with us in this community, that we may be glad witnesses of your goodness, O Holy One. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Christ, the wounded healer, has overcome all that threaten us. Let his resurrection power bring healing and hope to those for whom we pray, especially. Give thanks to God, who is good, whose mercy endures forever. We offer our grateful gladness this Easter day, especially for Christ has died and is risen, bringing life and immortality to light. We remember those who have died, especially may they live in him and share in the joy of Easter. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Gracious, eternal, and loving God, you have anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and raised him from death on the cross into resurrection life. Feed us with his life as we eat and drink with him in this Easter Eucharist, that we may be his witnesses, sharing in the Spirit's work of reconciliation and peace. Through the risen one, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
And now may the peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
And now please join with me in praying for those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this week. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants in the journey of their lives. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace, and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And now walk in love as Christ loved us.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. And now, if you'll join me in praying. O most loving Jesus, O most blessed Savior, come to me, I beseech you, and unite me to yourself. Though I cannot now receive you sacramentally, yet I believe that you are able, even when received by faith and desire only, to heal, enrich, and sanctify me. Come spiritually into my heart. I desire to unite myself to you with all the affections of my soul. Possess me wholly. Let the consuming fire of your love absorb me, and your presence abide so intimately in me that it will no longer be I that live, but you who lives in me.
Amen.
God has raised Christ from the dead, and all creation is made new. Alleluia. Christ is risen from the tomb and become your salvation. Rejoice and be glad. God's Spirit lives and breathes resurrection into your life. Live with joy. And the blessing of our wondrous God, the one holy and undivided Trinity, be with you and renew you now and forever.
Amen.
This morning we have been to church. Let us go into the world boldly to be the church. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.